Yeah. Okay. So I would like just to start with a quick presentation of Groupe L'Occitane. And with a quote of our chairman and chief executive officer saying that at the very heart of our business are authentic products anchored to their heritage. And I will explain what is really behind, because as you mentioned, it's really hard sometimes to balance with different objectives. And the whole point of this presentation is to see how the Groupe L'Occitane balance with growth objectives and also original commitments, because commitment is really at the very beginning of L'Occitane story. What Reinhard is saying is that this product is a really a resilient business model and a sustainable development have allowed us to achieve strong performance. So there is really much no contradiction between development and commitments. Commitment is really key to build a resilient business model, according to Reinhard, and I guess for company we try to do it every day. So I don't know if you are familiar with Groupe L'Occitane, but it's a cosmetic group with four different brands. So the main one, and I will really put the focus on L'Occitane, is of course L'Occitane, born in Provence. But there is also L'Occitane au Brésil, Melvita, which is an organic cosmetic brand, and Herbalife. So at the very beginning of L'Occitane in 1976, there is this man, which is Olivier Bossan. He created L'Occitane really to in Provence, using the plants and natural ingredients which were and are still around him. So there is a direct link with the nature at the very beginning. It started this way.
And then still drive the car? Or
no, so and we see there is no more car like this, but even if you can love the vintage car. I would like to mention two other important dates, which is the beginning of the 1980s. Olivier Bossan, him again, visiting Africa, heard about very amazing ingredients called shea butter, used by women in Burkina Faso. And a few months after, he created a new range with shea butter. And it's a very, very successful range. And so he needed more and more shea butter, and he created a sustainable supply chain, and which is a certified fair trade. So once again, it's Olivier Bossan who decided to start a business in a very fair trade way. And the last date is 1997. He decided for the first time to put braille on our packaging to help visually impaired people to understand what the product was about. So once again, it's really his decision. And this is very much the legacy of Olivier Bossan, which is not anymore, he's still working for the company, but he doesn't take decision. Important decision anymore, but it's really his legacy. Linked to nature, fair trade, and also philanthropy action. So now, L'Occitane, sorry, so no more car, but very amazing growth. It's 1.3 billion euros turnover each year. It's 8,000 employees in the world. It's a lot of stores as well. So of course, the story is completely different now. And the whole point is really how we could go on. And I will not say not just go on, because we talk about legacy, but really to improve and do better and better when it comes to sustainable business. So of course, there are lots of things that teams are doing, but I will just put the focus on a few examples. So what are our main assets to maintain a sustainable business? I would like to mention three of them. The first one is our expertise and our laboratory, it's called Natural Labs, and it's really the objective is really to provide the very best of plants and to use naturally derived ingredients. So it's really about the way we formulate our products in a very sustainable way. The second pillar is our ingredients again, but I would mention more the way we supply our key ingredients. So we set up a sustainable supply chain with a very direct relation with our producers. We help them to cultivate, and we buy in advance the harvest, so they can invest in and produce ingredients in a sustainable way. So there is a program, it's called Sustainable Communities. We have a special department, and it's really based on local sustainability, traceability, and equity. And the last part is more global, it's our CSR policy with a more 360 approach, different aspects, governance, packaging, curry field, responsible purchasing, and so on. So three very important assets at the core of business and at the core of the way we formulate and we produce our products. So where... could you go back? Sorry. Yes. What I would like to mention is that with this framework or this business model was first created by L'Occitane team. But now it's really a framework for all our brands. And I would like just to mention this the example of L'Occitane Brésil. So it's a different brand using ingredients from Brazil. And the team set up the exact same sustainable supply chain to source the Brazilian ingredients. So it's really a framework that could be duplicated for the different brands. So where do we stand now? Of course, there are many data and indicators, so I will just put the focus on a few of them. So it's more than 100 producers with direct relation with L'Occitane. It's more than 10,000 women in Burkina working to produce shea butter. And what is important is that L'Occitane boils shea butter and not but shea nuts. So it means that part of the added value is localized in Africa. You can go on, because I have an example. So I mentioned also a huge number of sustainable ingredients, eco-refills, naturality of the products. We have also data about carbon footprint. By the way, I brought some leaflets, so help yourself after the conference if you want to have more facts or figures about Stan. So they are really concrete. It's not only a global view or global framework, they are also very concrete actions and results. And I would like to just to finish about this, and I go back to what Ryan Geiger said. It's really, for us, our sustainable agenda is key to have a resilient business. And for three reasons. The first one, of course, is that the customers expect from companies to be committed to have a sustainable agenda. So we have to answer customers' expectations. The second reason is it's just the market new standards. So of course, L'Occitane, and we are very proud to be a committed brand for many years now, but it's true that the competition is more and more tough because all companies now have a sustainable agenda. So it's definitely now part of the market standards, so we have no choice. And the last point, the last reason of course is to attract and retain talents. It's absolutely key. It's part of the motivation of the employees. And when, of course, sometimes I have to hire some new employees, and all the time, all candidates mention the fact that we are a committed brand. So, of course, it's part of the expectation of young professionals, and it's definitely very, very important to attract them and to keep them motivated. So that's it. Sorry, maybe I was too long. Last part is really just finish with this, which is the cover of our corporate CSR report, Alexander Group Cares. So you will find a lot of information in it on our corporate website. I would like just to mention one last engagement we are working on, and I guess it's something that will interest you. L'Occitane was one of the company at the very beginning of the test, which is, I don't know if you know this test, it's kind of TOEFL or TOEIC, but for sustainability. And of course we have to be to have a clear agenda, but we would like to go beyond and also be part of this education initiatives around sustainability.
Okay, very good. Thank you very much. Yes, Dennis, you were a little long, but it was worth it, I think. I think the story, which goes like a red line with a commitment already from the founding fathers of the company all the way through, I think